Hi there and welcome back. I'm here with Natalie, one of the museum's scientists, and today we're going to be talking everything you've ever wanted to know about taste. Thanks for coming along today, Natalie.
Oh, you're very welcome.
Yeah. So why is taste important? Why don't I just eat something and it just tastes absolutely nothing?
So most mammals, and in fact quite a lot of vertebrates as well, have these five basic tastes. So there's sweet, there's sour, there's salty, there's bitter, and there's umami, which is a brilliant word. Mm-hmm. So each of these tastes we think has a really good evolutionary reason for its existence. So bitter is a really good one for detecting things like toxins. Mm. So it's a good way for animals to be able to detect whether something is actually safe to eat or not. The sweet taste is probably about nutrition. So if something's really sweet, it suggests it's really high in sugars and carbohydrates, which means it's really good for that animal to get lots and lots of energy really, really quickly. Umami is about tasting meat. Acid is about sour, sort of acidic stuff. Yeah. And then the final one being salty, which is about sort of electrolyte balances. So we all need a little bit of salt in our diet, and so it can help animals make sure they have that.
Right. How many taste buds do we as humans have?
So humans are reasonably good at tasting. We've got about 10,000 taste buds. So other animals have far fewer. So things like dogs only have about 1,700. We think lions have got about 470. Chickens have got very few. So your chicken is really not tasting anything much excitement. But then there are some things which taste way better than us. So things like pigs actually have 15,000 taste buds. So they're really enjoying everything that you're putting out for them to eat.
And why might these animals have different numbers of taste buds? Is there something to do with how important taste is to them?
Yeah, completely. So for some animals, so particularly animals that are omnivorous, so things that eat lots of different kinds of foods like we do, it's really important to be able to taste and detect different kinds of foods as well. So one really strange one perhaps is that cows have 25,000 taste buds. But we think that's because although it seems like they probably only need to be able to detect grass, they actually need to be able to work out what small plants are actually edible and which ones might have toxins in them that might make them feel unwell or even kill them. And so they have this really sensitive sense of taste for that reason.
Yeah, and I think that insects, they have really unusual taste buds to help tell more about plants as well.
Yeah, so insects, so you've probably seen flies and butterflies sort of treading around on like rotting fruit and stuff like that. So their taste buds are actually in their feet. So they have these chemoreceptors that they can use to detect sort of high levels of sugar. So again, to see whether a food is going to be particularly nutritious for them to feed on.
Yeah. And is there, you know, what would you say is the animal that has the most taste buds, you know, the most sensitive to these kind of signs from the environment?
Yeah, so the winner of the kind of taste bud competition is the catfish. So I'm saying catfish, there's about 3,000 species of catfish, but all catfish are covered, completely covered from head to toe, fins, in their like taste buds. So they have taste buds on their fins, they have lots and lots of taste buds on their whiskers, which you can see in the specimen that we've got here. It's got some whiskers. And so what they do is to try and detect lots of different foods in the water. And so in particular, they're looking for stuff that's rotting. And it's often in really sort of cloudy, murky water, so it's quite hard to find. So they've got all these taste buds, so they can detect teeny, teeny, tiny amounts of the amino acids, the things that make up the proteins in the food, and then they can get to that food as quickly as possible. And so we think that their sense of taste is about 100,000 times better than a human's.
Wow.
So pretty impressive, and also pretty sad for the catfish because often they're swimming now in quite polluted waters, which particularly around the UK at the moment might not be a very pleasant thing to be swimming through and tasting every single thing.
Yeah, I mean, is it something, can you see the taste buds, or are they just far too small to
They're really, really tiny, so you can't see them, unfortunately, on the specimen, but he's still a cool little catfish.
Yeah. So, yeah, and what have we got next to the catfish?
So I thought it would be kind of fun to have the catfish and also the cat, because we were talking about cats in the video. So this is just a normal domestic cat. But what you can see from the skull is the amazing teeth that they've got. So the really sharp canines on the front, and then these really nice sort of slicing teeth for cutting up meat. And so cats are what we refer to as hypercarnivores, which means they pretty much only eat meat, yeah. and a lot of it. And I should say, when we were talking about cats in the video, we don't just mean the cat that you would see at home. We also mean, you know, lions, tigers, all felids, so yeah. all cats. None of them can taste sweet stuff.
I mean, is this something that, you know, say a saber-toothed tiger perhaps, you know, would that have been able to taste this, or is this, you know, kind of just something that's more recent?
That's a really good question. I don't know if anybody's actually dated when this mutation happened. But like we were saying in the video, because it's a neutral mutation, so it doesn't actually really affect whether the cats live or die, it might be a little bit difficult to detect how far back in the sort of cat lineage this happened.
So, you know, do neutral mutations happen in us? Are they quite common in nature?
Yeah, so we think they're really common. So, you know, we're mostly thinking when we talk about evolution about things which might be like an advantage or a disadvantage to an organism. But most of the changes in the genome that are happening are just neutral. They're not good or bad. Often they're really tiny changes we don't detect at all. Or occasionally there'll be weird changes like this one where we can detect something. It does affect the organism, but it doesn't do anything particularly bad.
And I mean, you know, is that, how's that kind of happening? Because obviously there's no evolutionary sort of selection particularly going on there if it's not having a big or a negative and positive or negative impact.
Yeah, so when we talk about selection, the idea there is that you have a gene which might be, say it's a good gene, and it helps the organism, and then that organism can go on to have more offspring. So that gene gets passed through to successive generations. That's what we mean by selection. Yeah. When we have a neutral mutation, then it will just get passed on neutrally. So it won't mean that that organism has more or fewer offspring at any point. It's just going to sort of drift through the population. And that's another mode of evolution. So different to natural selection, we have this thing called genetic drift. And so populations can also evolve through this genetic drift. So rather than it being selected towards things that are good or away from things that are bad, it's just completely neutral.
Okay. I think, unfortunately, like we could keep on going, but I think, unfortunately, that is all we've got time for today. So, you know, thank you very much for being here and explaining it to me and to everyone at home. And yeah, hopefully we will see you again soon. If you'd like more sweet science facts, or even salty, bitter, sour, or umami, then why not like and share this video and subscribe for more content from the Natural History Museum.